rise till we fall. They say we got no future at all. They wanna keep us out, can't hold us down anymore. We gonna rise till we fall. When we hit the bottom,
must be so. Good evening, everybody, and you're all very, very welcome to the UCD Arts and Humanities Open Evening. Cead míle fáilte libh go léir. Delighted to have so many of you joining us from all parts of Dublin, from all corners of Ireland, from the UK, from the US, from Europe and beyond. You're all very welcome and thank you so much for being here tonight on this brutally cold evening. I'm going to start by introducing you to everyone who's on the call this evening. First off, we are joined by colleagues Gillian Pye, by Roisin Gaia Nicholson, and by Stephanie Ford. Thank you for joining us, Roisin, Steph, and Gillian. We are also joined by three students. So I'd like to introduce Niamh Scully and Rebecca Duffy and Jamel White, who are going to talk to you a little bit about what it's like to study in UCD, about their experience here and what you can expect. But first off, what we're going to do is play you a little video, which will give you a sense of our beautiful campus and some of the people who work and study here and the kinds of things that you will learn and the kinds of things that you will do. We will then cut to Gillian Pye, our Dean of Undergraduate Studies, who will give you a little bit of insight into our courses, the subjects that you can study here at UCD, and also the kinds of skills that you will learn, the opportunities that are here, and the types of careers that our graduates go on to enjoy across multiple industries. So first off, we'll play the video, and then next you'll hear from Gillian, who will talk to you a little bit about our courses here at UCD. Before we start the video, I might just ask you all to make use of the Q&A button here at the bottom of the screen. We are here for you to answer your questions, to hear what you want to hear. We know it's a very uncertain time, so we would love to hear what you need to know, and we will do our very best to answer as many of the questions. So sit back, relax, and enjoy this short video clip, and then you will hear from Gillian. Thank you all so much for joining us tonight.
I was always drawn to UCD. The moment that I came here on open day, it was almost like a home away from home.
I chose UCD for its diversity in the student population, as well as kind of the diversity in interests.
There's a huge range of modules on offer for English students and for creative writing students that really let you focus on specific areas of the subject.
The reason I personally chose UCD is it's the only university in Ireland that had English classics and history together.
Their music school is so highly renowned and it has so many extracurriculars to offer, such as the symphony orchestra, the Philharmonic Choir, the choral scholars.
I'm studying international modern languages. I'm in my final year. I think the main attraction for me was the third year Erasmus. I was lucky to go for a full year to Spain. I got an insight into the culture as well as improve obviously my language skills.
I think what makes UCD unique is the sheer breadth of the opportunities provided for students.
At the moment, I'm doing an internship with the National University of Ireland as part of the Humanities programme. I'm getting to edit documents for publications. I'm transcribing lectures from politicians.
I started doing opinion pieces through my work on the Students' Union for the Irish Times. And so I did a placement there for 3 months. And now next, I'm doing a journalism placement in British Vogue.
For me, what makes UCD unique is that we make a real effort to make a connection between our research and our teaching.
We get to bring so much of the interesting stuff that we're doing out there in the world into a classroom.
The tutors and lecturers that I have here in UCD are wonderful.
They'll actively engage with you and really try to get to know how you learn.
I think a university is defined by its students, and we're really fortunate in UCD to have excellent students.
The students who pick Arts and Humanities in UCD are very open-minded students. In a way, they're questing in their subjects of interest.
The importance of an Arts and Humanities education cannot be underestimated. It encourages students to think a bit beyond their own world and their own life, to take a different perspective on it.
You're always encouraged to sort of think critically about things and examine everything around you.
The vibe in UCD is lively.
There's always something going on, there's always an event taking place.
There's such a lovely feel across campus.
You're never going to get bored and you're never going to stop meeting people.
There's a big circulation of students around the space, a lot of students collaborating on things together, either in their courses or also in societies and clubs. Lots of them are involved in things outside their subject area, and they'll often bring that interest into the classroom.
So whether it's classics or drama or visual art, you have all of these student-led activities which add another dimension.
You can meet people in your course, but you can meet people outside your course by joining all of these societies, by hanging out into social spaces, and it'll really open you up to new experiences and to new people.
Our Arts and Humanities graduates become researchers, readers, linguistic experts, critical thinkers. They're also teachers, performers, creative writers, journalists. They're the people who shape culture. They're the people who help us understand culture.
And in a sense, perhaps, if we think about UCD as being both a base and a launchpad for these folks' career, that's really its intersection with the wider cultural scene.
UCD has produced so many stellar writers, people like James Joyce. He's one of our most famous graduates.
We have people like Emma Donoghue, Colm Tobin, and of course we now have writers on the faculty like Anne Enright, for example.
The manner in which UCD graduates can be found at home and abroad tells you of the quality of the education they received here and the quality of the student who passes through these doors.
My advice to anybody coming to UCD to study with us is to come with an open mind, be ready to be challenged and to be moved outside your comfort zone.
There's all of these opportunities to try new things, to meet new people, to go new places.
It is that diversity of experience here through the clubs, through the social scene, the quality of the library, the UCD archives, the interest in the classroom, all blended together.
I've always been a strong believer in the saying, create with the heart and build with the mind. And I feel like that's definitely something I've been able to do here in UCD.
Get involved and run towards the things that you're scared of, please. It'll be the best thing you do.
Okay, I think that gave you a little bit of an insight into our campus and into what we do here at UCD. So I hope that you found that interesting. It's great to be here tonight and you're all very, very welcome. My name's Gillian Pye and I'm the Associate Dean for Arts and Humanities here, which means that I look after and responsible for all of our BA undergraduate programmes. I know that it's a very difficult situation at the moment. The CAO deadline is approaching. The future is for everybody at the moment, I think, a little bit uncertain. And so in all we say today, we in no way minimize that. We acknowledge that absolutely. But I think that one thing we can say is that we will get out of this current situation and things are going to get better. And what we want to do today is to help you make the most informed and the most positive choice that you can about your next step, so that you can find the right way to study the subjects you love in a place that supports you and in a place that stimulates you. So I'm just going to, for 5-10 minutes, run through our main programmes again, the main features, the differences between them, and we'll have plenty of time at the end of the session for any questions that you might have, however big or small, for me or for any of my colleagues. So I'm going to share my screen with you now, I hope. Well, Roisin, you're going to have to let me share the screen, because I can't currently do it. That's it, absolutely, that is great. Okay, can we all see that now, I hope? That's difficult, get to the slideshow. Okay, I can play that from the beginning. So what you can see there are our three main programs, and each of our programs have a different structure. Each are combining subjects in a different way, and they're also different lengths.
Gillian, I think it's still on notes, but I can't see your presentation there.
Can't see the notes. Oh dear. Okay, we'll have another go. The joy of. Okay, I will try again. Can you see it now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All good.
Okay, sorry about that, everybody. Thanks very much, Moshi. So three main programmes. We have the BA Humanities, we have the BA Joint Honours, we have the BA Modern Languages, and they're each combining subjects in different ways. They're each different lengths. So when you're thinking about what programme you'd like to do, it's important to think about how you want to study the subjects you love. You might think, for example, about how long you want to study a subject for, and that might depend on what you want to do later, whether you know, for example, you want to be a teacher and you want to do PME, or whether you want to do postgrad study. Or you might also think about how much flexibility you want. How much flexibility do you need? Do you want to test the water,
or are you absolutely sure you know what you want to do from the start? So those are some general things to be thinking about. So I'll talk first about the BA Joint Honours, which is the oldest of our programmes and probably one of the best known. And it's a programme that allows you to combine two subjects for your degree. So that might be French and history, or it might be film studies and art history. And I'll come back in a minute to the huge range of subjects that we have available. What's really special about this programme is that it gives you flexibility. So in the first year of the programme, you can study modules from three different subjects and you can explore then which two suit you best. And in your second year, you go on to confirm which two are right for you for your BA degree. So this is a really good programme if you've got two specific subjects in mind, but you kind of want a bit of flexibility, you want the chance to try something new. It takes 3 years to complete the degree, so that leaves you in a good position to move on to a job straight away, if you like, or to go on into postgrad study. And just to give you a flavour of the subjects, you can see on your screen 21 subjects. These are the 21 subjects that we offer in arts. In addition to that, we also have some social sciences subjects combinable with some of our subjects, and those are sociology, maths, archaeology, philosophy. And our 21 subjects in arts are housed in 7 schools. And so even though it's a big programme, even though UCD is a big university, the schools are the smaller places where you get to know each other and where you get to know your fellow students, where you get into contact with your lecturers and other students, often in small group teaching. The BA also gives you the chance to spend a year abroad if you want to. So you can spend a year abroad in Europe, in Norway, in Germany, in Italy, but also outside Europe, perhaps in Australia or Canada or Japan. And that's up to you. You don't have to decide that until you're in your second year. But if you do decide to do that, your degree takes 4 years in total and it becomes a BA International. And we know the value of that year abroad for our students, not only intellectually, but also in personal terms, the kind of personal growth that goes on, the maturity and the experience that you develop while you're on your year abroad really stands to you later on when you're looking for a career or also in your degree. So we see students coming back from that year abroad doing really extremely well. So that's a quick overview then of the BA. And I'll move on now to talk about the BA Modern Languages. And as the title suggests, the BA Modern Languages is a programme for students who love languages. It's a 4-year programme that has a built-in year abroad, and all the students on this programme will study at least 2 languages, sometimes 3, that's possible. And the 4 languages that we have available are French and German, Italian, Spanish. German, Italian, Spanish are all available from beginners or from post-leaving cert level, from advanced level, and French is available from advanced level only. You can also do modules in Portuguese as well. So that's a really great programme if you know that languages is the thing for you, and we know that languages open many, many doors in career terms. It really is something that's incredibly important, and we see those students going into all kinds of areas of work and bringing their language skills and many other skills as well with them. I'll talk a bit now about the BA Humanities, which is the newest of our programmes, and this programme offers you a chance to pick one of 13 pathways. And what's special about this programme is that you decide right from the start what it is you want to do, what interests you have, and you're going to be combining them. It's a 4-year programme, and the extra year just gives you a chance either to do more UCD modules to kind of deepen your experience of your subjects, or to take the opportunity to do an internship. And some of our students today are doing internships or have done internships, and they can tell you a bit more about that. Or you can do study abroad, either for a year or for a semester. So there's lots of options in that third year of the programme. I just want to show you now the pathways that we have on offer in the BA Humanities programme. Some of them are focused on a particular specialisation from the start. So that might be history or English literature or English with creative writing. But what's unique about many of these pathways is that they're combining subjects in a way that allows you to explore how they relate to one another. So we saw in the video Azra there talking about English classics and history, and UCD is the only institution to offer that, and it gives students a really great opportunity to get a rounded understanding of the past and the way that culture is transmitted through history, through literature. We've got some new pathways. We've got global studies, European studies, and that allow you to combine political, historical, cultural, literary insights with linguistic studies to think about Europe in its place in the wider world, or to think about the global and globalization as a kind of concept. We have a new pathway also in Irish language, literature and translation, which gives you a really thorough grounding in the Irish language, but also the very rich culture associated with it, and an introduction to the theory and practice of mediating between Irish and other languages. And that's a crucial skill at the moment, particularly as Irish is about to become an official working language of the EU. I've got a slide here now that also, and I mentioned internships as a special feature of this programme. In your third year, you would have a chance to go out on internships. And I just have on this slide here some examples of some of the organisations with whom we have internship relationships, like the Museum of Literature in Ireland or the Little Museum of Dublin, broadcasters like News Talk. And we heard Jamel in the video there talking about his internship with the National University of Ireland, and we'll hear some more about that. Even during the pandemic, even during this really, really difficult time, students did go out on internship and they made the most of it. They really have had a fantastic experience. So that's only set to get better and bigger in the future as we go on. You've seen our campus on the video, and it is very much, I think you got a sense of that, a really vibrant hub which brings everything together, this diverse mix of people and social and sporting and cultural and intellectual resources. And it's also a beautiful green space. Now, obviously, at the moment, very, very few classes have been happening on campus. But the campus has been open for students as much as was possible. So the students have been able to access the library, the residences have been open, and support services. And student life has continued, and it's continued online. In my own area, in German studies, our German society has been meeting regularly online. I know that Niamh is very involved in DramSoc, and she might talk to you about how that's been going. I can't tell you how our return to campus is going to be managed. I can't tell you exactly when that is going to happen, but I can say that it will happen as soon as it can, and that we're super eager to return. We're not a remote learning institution. This campus is the heart of what we do. And facilities like the Classics Museum, like the cinema, like the rehearsal spaces, like the archives, the library, the lakeside even, the coffee shop where students get together and talk about ideas, those are our labs. That's where a lot of our work and really important work happens. And we can't wait to welcome students back to them. And I hope that that's going to happen very, very, very soon. Just a little word about careers. I think that often people think, when they think about arts and humanities graduates, they think, well, that maybe they're teachers and journalists. But the fact is that arts and humanities degrees mean they're very flexible, and people go to work in all kinds of sectors, from business, from innovation, from law to finance. We have a lot in our brochure, a lot of really specific case studies, if that's something that interests you. So I would encourage you to really have a good look at that, and look at the specific areas that people go into. The reason that arts and humanities graduates are sought after is because the skills are so transferable. You're learning to reflect, you're learning to question, to argue, you're learning to negotiate, and you're doing it in writing, you're doing it in oral presentations, in creative projects as well, like posters, like podcasts, like videos. And so on the one hand, our disciplines are scientific, they're working with facts, they're working with evidence. But what's really important, what's really distinctive, is that we are dealing with the human context, we're dealing with emotions, we're dealing with imagination. And those are the things that give meaning to facts, those are the things that give context to facts. And our graduates are, for that reason, particularly ready to deal with a future working world where we're going to increasingly need to bridge the gap between technologically very advanced workplaces and the human. So I hope that that gives you some kind of insight into just how far an arts degree can take you. I just want to finish up by saying, again, mentioning if you would like to have a copy of our brochure, do let us know, because it's really extremely useful to have it to hand. That's all I want to say for the minute. Now, I want to introduce a little video, which is going to give you an insight into each of our 7 schools that you heard me mention before. So you can see some of the people and some of the places associated with them.
UCD School of English Drama and Film. Now, our school is home to over 60 lecturers and professors who specialize in a wide range of literature, film, drama, media, and creative writing. And together with the students who take our programs of study at undergraduate and postgraduate level, we form a very vibrant, friendly, and engaging community, passionate about our subjects and passionate about sharing our knowledge, skills, and enthusiasm with others. We do this through classes, through lectures, through tutorials and workshops, but also through a whole range of other activities, screenings, performances, readings, etc.
It's a real pleasure to be head of the School of History and to have this opportunity to welcome you to our open day today. The School of History here at UCD is the largest in the country, and it's ranked in the top 100 in the world with internationally renowned faculty. And one of the advantages of this is that it enables us to cover a tremendous chronological breadth. So we can bring you from early medieval Ireland's place on the edge of the Roman Empire right up to the end of the Cold War. History is about human experience. It's about all of human experience. It incorporates how humans have imagined, lived, and built their various worlds, be it life in Viking Dublin over 1,000 years ago, or in dictatorships in Europe's 20th century. So if you're interested in humans, in how we've related to each other, in how we've related to our various environments, then history is surely the subject for you.
You're all very welcome. My name is Philip Cottrell, and I'm a lecturer in the School of Art History and Cultural Policy at UCD. All walks of life now use images so much. Wherever images are used persuasively or extensively to communicate ideas, an art history degree is going to give you a certain edge, because it really tries to fashion a heightened visual awareness, a more advanced sense of visual acuity, an understanding of how works of art function as a tool of propaganda and communication. So wherever images are used, whether it's in publishing, the media, advertised, but also increasingly in business, there is going to be some aspect of your experience as an art history student, which is going to give you a certain edge and a certain insight into the way images are used.
As Misha Regina Ecolatine, agus is kin the scholar me a school in the Gaelic and Leon Helchi agus and Veiligis. I am the head of the School of Irish Celtic Studies and Folklore, and I am delighted to welcome you here today. We are really enthusiastic about our area, and we have 4 disciplines within the school. For somebody who has been engaging in this all my life, I would certainly say, you know, if you want to do any of the 4 subjects, and particularly maybe in Irish language, with many, many doors opening up at the moment, it's a very, very dynamic area to be in. And I certainly have found, you know, that I for example, started out as a primary teacher and traveled the world with Irish and enjoyed the experience of meeting many wonderful people working in Irish and many guises all over the world. I'm just going to give you just little things. This is one of our online repositories. These are all the talks that we have done on online over the years. And if you want to get just a little bit of a flavour of what we do, you're very welcome to go online onto the website of our school, and you will find this SoundCloud list of lectures. And please do. And finally, we're on Twitter, we're on Facebook, and we're on Instagram. So please do follow us. We are quite active on them, and we love to engage with the social media in that way. And it's a great way of seeing what we're at. And finally, this is where you will be coming if you come to our School of Irish Celtic Studies and Folklore.
Hello and a very warm welcome to you all, wherever you are. Many of you will be in Ireland, some of you will be in Europe, and many will be further afield. And I'm sure that I'm talking to a multilingual audience, as befits our school and the subjects that we offer. My name is Siobhan Donovan, and I teach German in the School of Languages, Cultures and Linguistics at UCD. So I'm talking, but I'm joined here by many of my colleagues who are all representatives of the different subjects. And you have some of the faces here. So on their behalf, I say to you, bonjour, guten Tag, buongiorno, welcome, hola, salut, and hello. So here you can see the subjects that we offer in our school, the School of Languages, Cultures, and Linguistics, and the flags of the main country in which the languages are spoken. Also the levels at which we offer these subjects.
I'm the curator of the Classical Museum, and we are really lucky in UCD to have this as a resource because we're the only university in Ireland to have a classical museum. It's also the only collection of classical antiquities in Ireland that you can see on display. We've got material from Greece, Rome, we've got some Egyptian stuff, we've got some material from Cyprus, and this crosses a whole range of different types of things. So we've got pottery, we've got inscriptions, we've got glass, we've got loads of coins, 4,000 coins, so all kinds of things. And it's very much a teaching museum. So we use this in our teaching across the MA and the BA programs. So from first year right through your degree and on, if you stay on to study at postgraduate level, you'll get in here, you'll get hands-on experience with artifacts, and you'll be able to see how we draw on the material across all of our teaching and across all of our subjects in classics.
You may already be aware of this, but one really unique factor in UCD's music program is that we don't require an entrance exam or auditions for music, and that makes us very unique in Ireland. The curriculum, therefore, is really designed, and we've adapted it over the years, to be able to support both students who come to us with a high level of musicianship and knowledge of music theory already, but also support those students who maybe are already very talented musicians, but might not have that background, say, in classical music theory or be able to read musical notations. UCD has the largest humanities faculty in Ireland here in our college. And because of this, you guys as students get access to lectures, scholars, events, in all of these other disciplines, in history, in languages, in English, film and drama, in philosophy. And that means that all of that can kind of feed back and inform the way that you think about music. And I think that's really cool.
So thank you to Gillian for giving us that overview of the courses, really insightful, and to our colleagues from across our seven schools for introducing us to their schools. So we're moving to the next stage of the evening, and I'd really like to bring in Niamh, Jamel and Rebecca, if you could switch your cameras on, please, and come into the frame, as they say. And at this moment, I really do wish that we were all in a lecture theatre somewhere, all in the same room, but I suppose this is the next best thing these days. So I am going to just make sure that we can see everybody. Roisin, can I just check that we have our gallery view on? We do? Fantastic. So I'm going to introduce you first to Niamh Scully, who is a third year student in Classics, English and History. She has recently just completed her internship in the Little Museum of Dublin on St. Stephen's Green. And very kindly, she has recorded a little video to describe a day in the life or a life in the day of her time here at UCD. Niamh, could you tell us a little bit about the video before you introduce it?
Hi, everyone. As Emer has just said, I'm Niamh. And the video I recorded was actually our first day back in college, my first semester back since the second semester of my second year, so it was a good while. But I was on internship last semester, and I talk a little bit about that in my video. And then just I'm going through a typical day for me while we are studying at home. A very productive day now, I will add. It's not every day that I do this much work, but I work part-time as well, so it's important and productive on the other days. Yeah, I hope you enjoy. I hope it gives a little insight into UCD.
Hi guys, my name is Niamh and I am an Arts and Humanities Student Ambassador here in UCD. I'm a third year student on a humanities pathway studying Classics, English and History. So today I'm just going to be taking you through a typical day in my life in our first week back in college and answering some questions I get about my course and about studying in UCD in general.
So I try and get up at the same time every day just to maintain a bit of a routine, which is really difficult with online college. So getting up at the same time and doing the same thing in the morning really helps me. Just getting a cup of tea to go along with my studying for the day is a nice little routine I have in the morning. The night before, I always write down my goals for the next day in terms of the work I want to get done, as well as some personal stuff. So I have to do some household bits, as well as just reminders to get out for a walk and do a bit of reading for myself. Just nice little reminders for yourself. Here I am just writing down the different times I'm going to do different things, because, you know, I try to change up what I do in the morning and what I do in the afternoon day to day to keep it fresh. And then I was just doing a bit of work for one of my history classes. So I'm just doing some readings and listening to some audio files. And then I had a learning journal due, which is just a few hundred words reflecting on your readings for that week, which is a really common assessment to have, especially in second and third year, in subjects like classics, English and history. Then I just went on a walk with my housemate just to clear my head and get a bit of a break, which is really important. We just went down to our local coffee shop and got a nice little drink for a treat for all the work we had done that morning. There I am with the coffee. When I came home, I was doing a bit more work for one of my classics modules. I work 2 days a week as well, remotely. So it's really important for me to try and be productive on the days that I'm not working so that I'm not trying to work all through the weekend as well and that I do get a bit of a break. I was lucky enough to be on internship last semester. Going on internship is one of the great aspects of doing a humanities programme. I was working in the Little Museum of Dublin as an archivist and it was an absolutely incredible experience. This was just my final report.
So it's just coming to the end of the day now. So I'm just having my dinner at the moment and then I have a DramSoc committee meeting at 7. I'm currently the auditor for DramSoc here in UCD. And it's something that absolutely changed my life when I came to UCD. Getting involved in societies is such a brilliant thing to do and an absolutely great way to make friends and find a community outside of the friends you're going to make in your course as well. There's loads of societies here at UCD, so there's something for everyone and it's something I would really recommend getting involved in. Thank you so much for coming along with me today in my day in a life. And if you have any questions, you can direct them to student ambassadors such as myself over on Unibuddy, which you can get to via the My UCD website. Thanks, guys.
Thank you so much, Niamh. Love the video. Love the day in the life. Very productive, as you say. Are all days that productive?
No, but that was a good day. It was a good day.
Fantastic. Listen, it was lovely to hear about your internship. Can you tell us a little bit more about how you came to get that internship and what was the process and what you learned from it and how you think it will help you in the future?
Well, I was very lucky actually with my internship and coming to UCD to do it, because the internship with the Little Museum of Dublin was organised by our in-house internship manager. So she organises all of the placements. Well, you can also do like self-found ones as well, but she organises lots of different placements that you can then apply for through the Careers Connect website, which is also how you would apply for a lot of other jobs, kind of helped by UCD, which is a really, really good experience of like real world adulting, I suppose. So I applied for that. I did a CV and a cover letter, and then I had an interview and we obviously got on very well. And I was really lucky to be there last semester. And I still got to be in the museum every single day because I was working in the archives, which was such brilliant experience. And I never would have thought I could learn so much in such a short stint, but I'm staying on a bit with the team there as well. So it was really, really beneficial for me and my learning experience in UCD, absolutely.
That sounds fantastic. What a way to start the year, you know, with that under your belt. So thank you very much for sharing that with us. We might bring Jamel in next. Jamel, how are you doing over there?
Hi, how you keeping?
Good, thanks. Well, and yourself?
Yeah, no, excellent. I don't have a video prepared, unfortunately. I'm still reeling from seeing myself for the first time in that other one.
Well, but I was just going to say, you might recognize, to everyone gathered here in the call, you might recognize Jamel from the video that we played earlier.
A bit more haggard looking these days with the barbershop closed, but same guy. Yeah.
Not for a second. I just want to ask you, first of all, you're studying English with creative writing. You're in your third year now. What is English with creative writing like to study? What sort of modules are you doing? What kind of writing are you doing? What are you reading? I'd love to know a little bit more about your course.
Yeah, well, when you come into your first year of English with creative writing, you are kind of a 50-50 split with your creative writing and your English studies. So you're going to do the core modules in English that you're given, that most, well, anyone studying English is going to do. So you're going to be able to meet everybody that's already in English. So that includes, you know, the people doing the three-year joint honours. But what you're also going to have aside is in a much smaller kind of group. I mean, we've hundreds of people in English and creative writing. You might have 50 or 60. You'll have your creative writing guys. I think you've got lectures in first year, and I think they're continuing to do that. But you also have workshops, and workshops is where you will write every week. You will meet as a group. It is not so much a class in that there's a kind of relationship between, you know, a group of students and the tutor. It's very much an interactive experience. It's very much about each other's work. So you'll spend a lot of time reading each other's work, having your own work read, peer reviewing. You learn to give criticism. You learn to take criticism, two extremely important things if you want to get better at this. You come into second year, it opens up a lot more. You get to specify what areas of creative writing you want to do. You can choose between your English modules and your creative writing modules as you see fit. So for example, in second year, I took on a load of creative writing modules. I was doing fiction, poetry, and then I was doing one that was specifically for the short story. UCD has a huge range of English modules to choose from. So you really get to dive in there. Even in first year, you get a lot of choice. In my first year, I got to do comics and fantasy, which was and children's literature, which was not something which I thought would be something that would come later. By third year, it really, really opens up. I'm doing post-war US lit now, but I could have picked sci-fi, detective fiction. There's a huge list on the website that you can look into. I could be here all day naming them. Any more questions?
No, that's great. Thank you very much. And I'm going to invite Rebecca to join us next. Rebecca Duffy, how are you doing? Rebecca is joining us from France, where she is on a year off and doing an internship. Rebecca, how are you getting on over in France?
Great, yeah. So as you said, I'm on the internship at the moment in France. So I'm working in high schools over here and teaching languages, so teaching English. And it was actually an internship that was brought to me by UCD. So one of my professors recommended it because I had originally planned to go an Erasmus year, but with the situation at the moment, I was really unsure about going away for the year, and then it was cancelled. So this was just another option that was offered to me. So in the general route, if you're going to do an internship as part of your course, it could be something that you could do, this sort of internship abroad. That's an option on the language courses. So even though I'm doing it on my gap year, it is something you could do within your course as well.
Which is great to hear. And we're getting a lot of questions in. I'm going to come to specific questions in a moment. The Q&A button is on fire at the moment. But we're getting a lot of questions about what it's like to study a language, what kind of things you do. Is there a lot of essay writing? Is there a lot of language work? You're studying French as part of your course. Can you tell us a little bit about what that's like and the kind of things that you're studying?
Yeah, so there's kind of two aspects to studying a language. There's studying the language itself, so grammar, your comprehension and conversation. And then there's the other side, which is culture and literature. So in terms of the first one I talked about, so grammar and the actual language itself, there isn't much essays in that. It's more so listening comprehensions and oral exams and kind of the use of the language, whereas with literature and culture modules, there would be essays in them. So for example, I did a module in French film. So we watched French films and then we had to write essays on that and critically analyze them. So it would be the same with, sorry, my internet's a bit.
We just lost you for a second, but it seems to have cleared up there.
Yeah. Okay, perfect. So I was just saying, I took a module in French film and we watched that and then analyzed parts of the film. And then with literature modules, we'd read French texts, and then similarly, we would criticize them as well, or critically analyze them. And so the essays would more so be on that end, but I wouldn't necessarily say there's a lot of essays, kind of similar to any other course.
Okay, that's great. Thank you so much. We are getting a lot of questions on careers as well, in particular in relation to languages. So I might invite our associate professor Gillian Pye back into the room, who lectures in German. Can you give us a little bit of insight into careers with languages and the kind of careers that our students go on to enjoy with a language or two or three under their belt?
Oh my goodness. Well, that's difficult to answer in one sentence. What I can say is that students with languages are in demand. And when a student speaks a language proficiently, it certainly gives them the edge in an interview and in careers. And so our students really have gone into all kinds of areas. I mean, some of the obvious ones are things directly using the language, like translation. So we have people who've gone into that. But also in business, for example, in big companies like Lidl that are international, that could be really, really useful and important to have not only the language, but also kind of intercultural insights, the kind of things you get from a languages degree. We have many students who go into other areas of business and finance. Sometimes they convert and go into law. And wherever you are, if you have the ability to communicate with people from other cultures, and if you can do that in another language, that is only going to be helpful. So the opportunities really are, I would say, limitless.
Okay, well, that's good to know. We're getting a lot of questions as well about the difference between the 3 and the 4 year. If I can stick with you, Gillian, they're asking, can I do history and politics as a 3 year degree, for example? And also, can I swap between humanities and joint honours? Can you explain a little bit how the courses run alongside each other?
Okay, so just to answer the first question about history and politics, that is a 4 year programme now on the BA Humanities degree. And I suppose the four year structure really just allows you to bring those two subjects together in really quite a deep way. And you would have an opportunity, particularly at the end of that 4 year programme, to write an in-depth research project. And I think that's something, so that's testing out and using a lot of the skills that you would have developed in studying those two subjects. So at the moment, that is a four-year degree programme. So that's the answering that first question, I hope. The second question is about transferring between the two degree programmes, right? So I would say that, as I explained before, the BA programme, the 3 year programme, is set up to be very flexible. If you decide in your first year that you like the third subject better than the first two, you can kind of switch them around. So it is good if you're not quite sure and you want a little bit of flexibility. It is a little bit harder to transfer from the 3 year program into the 4 year program. And the reason for that is the 4 year program is designed for people who know what they want to do from the start, and they get started on that straight away. And so their modules are kind of, the pathway is a little bit more set out for you in terms of the modules that you're doing and the modules that you're doing in your chosen subjects. That said, if you start on the 4 year program and you've chosen a combination, and then you think, actually, this is not working so well for me, you can always transfer back into the BA, back into the 3 year program. So there are pathways between the two things. But I would say, if you are quite clear about what you want to do and you think the 4 year program might be for you, then start with that one. There is always the option to switch back to the 3 year program. The direction of travel in the other way from 3 to 4 is not quite so straightforward. I hope that makes sense. Does that answer the question, Eimear?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Thank you for that, Gillian. Mm-hmm. And then another question, English with creative writing. A few questions on that. I'm going to come ask you, Gillian, first, and then over to you, Jamal. We have someone in New York City asking about English with creative writing. But specifically for Gillian first, can I study English with creative writing and French, for example?
That is not offered as a programme. So English with creative writing is a discrete programme. But what the structure in UCD does allow you to do is to take elective modules, so modules outside your subject area, and those might be in a language. And we've got two ways of doing that in UCD. One is directly with the French department, which is where Rebecca's doing her French at the moment, or through the Applied Languages Centre, which offers all kinds of electives in different sorts of languages. So that gives you more opportunities. So that's absolutely possible if your timetable allows it. And that's what I can't tell you the detail of, is what your timetable would look like and whether that would specifically work out. But I would say you would certainly have a good chance of doing some French modules, but studying French as a subject with English and creative writing, that's not possible.
Okay, thank you. And sticking with creative writing and to our friend who is writing to us from New York, you're very welcome. Hope it's warmer in New York than it is here in Dublin. He's wondering, you know, he knows a lot more about American poets and writers, but doesn't know as much about Irish poets and writers. Do you think this is something that this student needs to be worried about, Jamel? And is there any advice you can give this student what they can get reading and researching right now?
No, absolutely not. It's definitely not something you worry about. I mean, you're coming to university for one very specific reason, and that's to learn. You'll be introduced to everything. Every module you do, everything you need to know is going to be in that module. And you're going to be encouraged yourself to go out and look at new things. But that's going to happen naturally because you're going to be introduced to things that interest you. So this is going to happen by osmosis. This is going to happen naturally. So I honestly, I'm not going to tell you to go out and buy this or buy that and read that. Just keep reading what's good to you. You'll eventually be able to bring that into your own writing as well, because the tutors here are very accommodating, but they're also very curious. And we do kind of encourage curiosity in that regard. So, I mean, what you bring to the table will be uniquely you, and it will be based on what you've accumulated over your time reading. So, I mean, no, just keep reading. It doesn't matter what it is. Just keep doing it.
Okay, that's great.
One top tip, sorry to interrupt, but
please go.
The Museum of Literature Ireland is an initiative that came out of UCD, and it's in the heart of Dublin and has a really excellent online presence. So this might be something, especially if you're outside of Dublin at the moment, that you might like to tap into. Museum of Literature Ireland, MOLI. That's all online. There's loads of content there. So if you are curious and interested in Irish literature, that's a really nice way to dip your toe in the water. But as Jamel says, you don't have to, but you might like to have a look at that.
That's a great tip. And we always like to nod to our alumnus, James Joyce, who studied at UCD. So it's nice to bring him into the conversation as well. Another question for Jamel, because I know you'll be able to answer this. What do the dorms look like both before and after the pandemic? I know
Jamel before and after campus. I did. So I lived on campus the past 2 years. I'm actually off campus at the moment. But I worked as a residential assistant out there. They're a very, very communal place. That is the word I use. It's a very, very lively environment, despite our best efforts to have it not be that way. But you're guaranteed to meet lots of great people when you live on a res. Even as an RA, I got to know some great residents from loads of different countries. If you're asking what they look like in terms of how nice they are, they're quite nice, I have to say. They kind of scale up from basic to a little bit more than that, but all levels of it are quite pleasant to live in, I have to say. And there's really nice courtyards. It's great to be on campus. It's great to, you know, roll out of bed and, you know, take 10 minutes to stroll to your lecture and then, you know, go back to bed after your lecture.
Good for you. That's good to hear. And there's a lot of questions coming in about campus life and societies. I might bring you in, Nia, first. Can you tell us a little bit about the kind of societies you got involved in and the types of things that you can do on campus in addition to your studies and the kinds of people that you meet?
So UCD is really, I think we've over 100 societies and sports clubs that you can get involved in. So anything you've done before college, anything your wildest dreams imagine, there is a club or a society for it. I know people who do juggling, who do cultural societies, people who do mountaineering.
We've lost you there for a minute. I think your Wi-Fi has gone. So we might just come back to you on that if that's okay. Rebecca, would you like to talk to us a little bit about campus? Like, oh, you're back. Hello again, Eve.
Hi, sorry, I didn't realize I'd gone. Oops.
It's okay.
Not sure what I was saying.
The world of Zoom. We might ask Rebecca to come in just while your Wi-Fi is coming back up.
Yeah, absolutely. So in terms of societies then as well, like if we're talking specifically about languages, there's one for French, Italian, Spanish, Japanese, Russian. So kind of any language you're interested in, there's a society for that. And they also organize trips abroad every year, which is a really great way to practice your language and then to meet other people who might not necessarily be in your course, but have like that common interest as well with languages. And I think one of the points that Niamh made there was that there's a society for everything. Like she said, juggling. I was involved with Amnesty International Society as well. There's St. Vincent de Paul. As I had said, just for everything and anything. And Niamh was quite involved with Dramstock as well. She was talking about that. And there's also Musical Society. So yeah, again, anything you're interested in, that there will be a society or a club for that.
Great. And what about you, Jamel? What are your thoughts on campus life and the vibe? So people who've never been to UCD, how would you describe the vibe?
Diverse. It's large here, but it's not it's not as intimidating as it might sound on paper when somebody tells you that there's, you know, 26 to 32,000 people. I think it's great. I mean, I used to love walking out on a Monday and walking down the concourse and just seeing all these faces. It made me feel like I was part of something bigger than what was happening in my immediate surroundings. It was, you know, beyond my own college courses and stuff. The societies, I was involved in Belfield FM, which was a great little community and a really kind of cool creative outlet that way. We did our own little kind of satirical literary podcast where we were bringing the writing that we did in class. So we were able to actually incorporate our classwork into it as well, into this kind of social, we had fun with it anyway. And it was a great experience because we got to figure out how to use all of the technology involved in broadcasting. As when I say we did, I say they did. I kind of took a backseat for that, but the option was there for me. I met most of my peers through societies. The Literary Society was a great one. Even for people who don't do creative writing, but have an interest in creative writing, people who go on to study English in a joint honor setting or a single honor setting can join Litstock. They do writers workshops. It was on a Wednesday. I can't tell you what day it is now, but I'm sure they're still, I think they are definitely still doing them online. Where, you know, people come every week and they share their writing or they write in these kind of group sessions with writing prompts. So that was a really, really good way to meet people, especially people that, I mean, because writing can be a very kind of, you know, it's a very personal thing. It can be quite, you know, it can attract an introvert, and sometimes the introverts are the most interesting people. So when you're in an environment where they're kind of encouraged to kind of let themselves loose, it's great. You really meet some great people.
And just actually to add to a point that you made there, I was quite shocked as well, like the amount of friendly faces you can make as well, because the university is so big. So you're actually surprised by the amount of times you can pass by a friend or, you know, like to have a friendly face on campus, even though, as I said, there's so many people there. Like it's, in terms of campus life, it is quite a friendly atmosphere, which is something that I didn't expect. I thought, you know, with so many people, you'd be a bit lost, but even just like if you're in the Newman building, like you'll definitely run by someone that you're friends with or that, you know, you've seen in a lecture before. So I think that's, something that I didn't expect and that people can kind of look forward to as well.
Thanks for that, Rebecca. I'm going to quick fire a few questions your way, Gillian, if that's okay. Hope you've had a chance for a drink of water. How many languages can you study in global studies?
In global studies, that's a really good question. In global studies, you have the choice of a lot of different language options as electives, but you don't have to do a language if you don't want to.
Okay, that's great.
But yeah.
And do you have to have any practical skills for studying art history?
As in being able to paint or being able to paint or draw?
No. Yeah.
No, it's not a practical art course in that sense. You have to have an interest in it. I think as with everything, that's the most important thing. Are you interested in it? Are you interested in visual culture? You don't have to be able to produce it yourself, but you have to be interested in learning how to read it and how to understand it.
Great. And we have Edie coming in from Minnesota, I do believe. How are you, Edie? Edie is asking about elective modules in creative writing. So if you're not taking creative writing, can you take elective modules in creative writing?
In principle, there are elective places in all of our modules in UCD. There are some exceptions. I don't think we allow people into medicine to practice on patients as elective students, for example. But there are elective places, but those elective places will be restricted and they're quite competitive. So it's, for some subjects, you know, you'll have a lot of students who want to do creative writing as an elective. So it's not guaranteed, but you can certainly apply for that. There are lots of other ways as well to get involved in creative writing. For example, with our two student newspapers and with student societies. So it doesn't always have to be for credit. It doesn't always have to be an elective. There are lots of other ways to get involved if you like writing things and you like being creative.
Okay, that's great. Thank you very much. And someone here wondering if, lights are gone out here. Hold on till I walk around. Sorry. if I am studying for the Joint Honours Classics, Classical Civilization and Drama, do you have to do a drama audition or is that just for the single drama? Or do you have to audition at all?
I think Niamh might be able to answer this better than me, but I don't think so. No, I don't think there are any auditions necessary for the actual programme. If you want to take part in a production, then yes, you're going to need to audition in some way or other. You don't have to be on the stage if you don't like to. The study of drama at university is quite often concerned also with kind of theories and practices and texts and not just standing on the stage.
Okay, that's great. And a specific question here in from Ellen, could someone choose music and economics as a joint honour? That's not something that we offer, right, Gillian?
I don't think so. No, music and economics would not be. I'm doing a little check, but no, that is not available.
Ellen, let us know if there's other combinations you're interested in the chat and we can get back to you on that. And actually, while we're on this, can we put up the link? If people would like to receive our brochure, we're very, very happy to send a copy of our brochure, which has all the details printed in it. So we're going to put a link here in the chat. So if you'd like to fill out your details in that link, we'll send a copy of our brochure along to those who want to find out more details about our courses in detail, if that's okay. Gillian, we have a Jami Pick coming in from South Africa. You're very, very welcome, Jami. Thanks for joining us. Great to know that somebody is in from a sunny country. I hope you're sending rays of sunshine our way. And Jami, understandably, is wondering about the travel rules and the uncertainty. What is a question on many people's lips? Gillian, what is the future looking like in terms of online classes and coming back to campus? I know that's a really difficult question.
Unfortunately, my crystal ball is at the repair shop, so I'm not able to answer that. What is the future for online teaching? That was the question there. And when we're going to, we absolutely, I cannot, it would be very unfair of me to make promises about when we're going to come back onto campus. We will come back onto campus as soon as we can, because we're not a remote learning institution. We are a campus-based institution. So we'll be doing that as soon as we can. And I imagine that will probably happen in a phased way. And what we do try to do, what we have been trying to do, is to be as clear with our students as we can be in terms of communication, and to also do that in a timely fashion, especially when people are coming from abroad, that you have the time to know whether you have to come back or not, whether you have to come to Dublin or not. And I think that the call will be made on that soon enough, certainly for students who are planning on moving to Dublin for September. I think that that's the best that I can say to you at the moment. I wish I could be more clear.
That's very fair. I know it's really uncertain times, and we really do feel for, you know, students on this call who are facing into the leaving cert. They don't know what the future holds. So I suppose as soon as we know, we will communicate with all applicants who are on our system. A lot of interest in European studies and languages in European studies. What's that going to look like, Gillian?
So, of course, it is. And the European Studies programme in UCD will involve the study of one language plus other subjects that revolve around the whole issue of Europe, European identity, history, Europe's place in the wider world. So this is not a kind of narrow way of looking at old Europe, but actually looking at Europe in its global context. And so being able to speak one of our languages, French, German, Italian, Spanish, would be really advantageous there. There's quite a lot of history content, of politics content, also of kind of content in terms of culture, in terms of the whole cultural imaginary of Europe. I think that's an important thing. It's not a politics, a squarely politics focused course. I think that's important to say. It's not a social sciences course. It's an arts and humanities course. So there's a lot more that has to do with the cultural imaginary in terms of the way that Europe has been imagined and thought of through history. So that's what you can expect on that program. I think, and the reason that we've chosen to go with one language is so that you've really got time to actually develop proper proficiency in that language as part of this program. That's really, really very important.
Okay, that's great. Now I'm just seeing a lot of questions here in the Q&A function about the various different combinations. So we're going to pop a link which links to our e-brochure in the chat function. And on page number 6, you'll see here, this is what we call the grid, the DN520 grid, which shows all the various different subjects. And where you see a tick, it means that you can enjoy that combination. So that will answer probably about 25 to 30 questions about specific combinations. So picking up on one, can you study music and history? So what you do is you go to music and to history, you go across the grid and you cannot study music and history. So that's the way to find out what combinations are available. Like Gillian said, we offer an awful lot of combinations and it's very bespoke, but you need to check each subject combination to see what is available. Mm-hmm.
And the reason that we don't offer all subject combinations is because it would be completely impossible timetable wise. We would have to stay up all night, all week. So there are some restrictions around it, but the combinations really are, there really are a lot. So it's worth having a look at that grid.
That's great. Okay, thank you very much. And we have a few questions on classics. And I'm thinking of you, Niamh, I wonder if you could come in and just talk a little bit about what it's like to study classics. And the kind of language element, if you're taking Latin, for example, we have a few questions about Latin. And what sort of modules, what sort of topics are you covering?
Well, classics is a very, very varied subject, which is honestly what I absolutely love about it. You don't have to study a language in undergrad. You don't have to study Latin or ancient Greek, but there are options to do that if you would like to. You can study Latin and ancient Greek as whole subjects as well. And we have some amazing professors who are really helpful in teaching different aspects of the language. One of my professors on a module this semester is giving us some Greek words every week just for fun, but she has promised she won't test us on them. There's so many different things you can do though. When I was in first year, I was studying kind of some archaeology modules, not actual archaeology, but like archaeology in classics, some different modules about like coins in the Roman Empire, and that whole kind of Age of Augustus era. And then I was also studying the epics, like the Odyssey, the Aeneid, the Iliad, as well as like introductions to Greek mythology and the gods. I personally have focused a lot on Greek tragedy and drama throughout my degree. And I've been very lucky that there is a professor who is so, so qualified to teach about that here. And he's been brilliant. I've taken all his modules. But like any subject in UCD, because we have such huge faculty, you can really choose what your interest is and take a majority of modules from that, as well as being able to switch between different things. So you can take subjects about Mesopotamia or Babylonia, and then you can also take subjects about the early Roman Empire. So it's really varied and you can really choose what suits you best. The faculty is amazing. I can't speak highly of them enough.
Thank you, Niamh. We're getting a lot of questions from mature students as well, who are wondering what is it like for mature students on campus? Are there a lot of mature students in our community? And what is it like for them settling in? Gillian, would you like to take that question?
Yeah, I think it's something that's very close to our hearts. Our mature students are, they do so well on our programs. I was running an exam board today looking at how well our mature students do. So I'd say that the mature students that are with us, they're really flourishing. And the numbers of mature students are growing. And we're also actively seeking to grow the numbers of mature students we have in our programs.
We have a mature student advisor in UCD who looks after the mature students. I think that you see the mature students looking after each other. I certainly see them interacting with each other in groups as well as with some of the younger students. So I think that there is actually plenty to support mature students as it stands right now. And they're very much part of our community. You're not over in a separate little group. I don't know if that answers the question really, but.
That does. And we've had quite a few questions. So thank you for that. Just have a note here from Barbara. She's dialing in from Greece and she's saying, nice to hear modules in Greek are taught. So how are you doing, Barbara? Thanks for that note. Very nice. we have a lot more coming in on careers relative to the subject. So if I'm studying history, what are the careers? Or if I'm studying classics, what are the careers? Or again, more questions on languages as well. And I think it's safe to say that, you know, the range of careers that Gillian spoke about earlier in her presentation in terms of media and journalism, business and innovation, law and advocacy, hold true to all subjects. Why is that, Gillian?
Yes, it's a really interesting thing about arts and humanities graduates, isn't it? I think that's the difficult thing about students thinking about going to university, because you just can't imagine, well, if I've done Greek tragedy and Babylonia, what am I going to do then with that? Am I going to get in a time machine and go back to ancient Greece? No, I'm not going to do that. The reason I think that people like arts and humanities graduates so much is because they're, for a first thing, they're excellent communicators. So they're really good at gathering knowledge, dissecting it, synthesizing it quickly, putting it back together and communicating clearly to other people. So anything that involves communications, either orally or in writing, our students are excelling. They're really adaptable and flexible. And I think that's another reason why companies and businesses quite like to take arts and humanities students, because they know they can train them up to do whatever it is that they do. And because the world of work is changing so quickly, that's actually a really good an advantage, I think, for arts and humanities students, because the employer will train you to do the things they want you to do. What they want you to do is to be able to think for yourself and to be able to learn quickly and to be able to take in information quickly. So all of those things that are things that arts and humanities students do well. I think that arts and humanities students bring great passion to what they do, and that is hugely important, that you bring interest to what you do.
Now, I think we've just lost you. Excuse me there, Jim.
Yeah, you lost me. Yeah. I'm sorry.
Stay with us.
My Wi-Fi going down, I think. It's telling me it's unstable. I'm sorry. I was talking about the passion that arts and humanities students bring to their subjects, because that is infectious. When you bring the love of what you do into any environment, that energizes people and people like to be around that. I think you can see that. You can see that with Rebecca and with Neve and with Jamal, that they're bringing huge energy into all the things they do, and their internship employers are absolutely loving that. That's important as well. And there are specific skills too. I mean, you know, we can talk about languages, we can talk about report writing, we can talk about kind of oral presentations and those kinds of things, which are very specific skills that you develop and you're then able to go on and use them in your job. But that's for me why people like arts and humanities students so much.
That's great. We have a couple of questions in specific to the humanities degree and the combination of Erasmus and internship. So one is specific to European studies, another is specific to history and politics. Is it possible to do both Erasmus and internship? And if so, when do you do it?
So in the DN530, in the BA Humanities program, the four-year program, it is possible to do a semester abroad and an internship, which would be a fantastic combination. And you can do either semester. You just need to organize it, to plan for it and to apply for those things. That's all perfectly possible. Or you can choose to do an internship and then stay at UCD for a semester, which is what Neve is doing this year. So that's all to play for.
Okay, that's great. About languages, many people on this call are wondering, can you start languages from scratch? And if so, which ones? So do I have to have done it in my leaving cert or in my A-levels or in my final year exams, or can I start from scratch? Can mm-hmm. you walk us through those details, please, Gillian?
Okay, so first of all, I would differentiate between wanting to study a language in general, just as alongside anything you're doing. So we have an applied languages center that offers loads of choice of electives in everything from Swahili to Japanese to French to Spanish to Italian, all of that, and they will offer everything from beginner's level. So once that fits with your timetable and you want to do a little bit of Swahili or a little bit of Spanish, you can do that alongside your main subjects. That's always possible. If you want to actually study a subject as a language subject, as a subject, then you would do that in the School of Languages, Cultures, Linguistics. That's my home in UCD. And there you have the choice of French, German, Spanish or Italian. And all of those languages apart from French are available from beginners or from advanced. So you can study German from beginners or advanced, Italian from beginners or advanced, Spanish from beginners or advanced. And we also offer some modules in Portuguese from beginners, but not as a full subject in the degree. Does that cover it?
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. Thank you very much. We are asked here by Amy, how are you doing, Amy? What are the transport routes like from campus? So I think it's safe to say, anyone feel free to come in here. You can pretty much get to UCD from any part of town by bus. Does anyone have some experience they'd like to speak about coming into campus?
I commuted for the first 2 years of my degree from the north side, which is two buses for me, but UCD actually has some really, really good transport links. On the main road, there's like 5 or 6 buses that go like through the south side and through into town. For me, even coming from the north side, there was actually a direct bus that I could get in the morning, which was really, really helpful. We're also only about like a 20-minute walk from the Dart. So there's a lot of transport links, and the bus comes like early in the morning, late at night. So there is some really good options. So it's not too difficult to get from if you're anywhere in Dublin.
And there's the two wonderful magical buses that I often think of, the 17, which pretty much goes everywhere, from Tala to Black Rock to Dundrum. It goes everywhere. And there's also the new, I think it's the 175 that comes in from West Dublin and catches a lot of neighbourhoods along the way.
It's also worth noting, it's also worth noting the 39A is now 24 hours as of like a couple of months ago.
That's a really, really handy bus as well. Really good, because it goes through town if you connect to anywhere from there. So it's very handy.
And we have Cara asking about the practical aspects of music at UCD. And just to say, there's no audition, Cara, for coming to UCD to study music. There is no practical element central to the modules. And Gillian, feel free to come in here, but there are many opportunities to practice music.
That's right. And I think that's something that's, that's something that's really unique about UCD, is that it opens up music to a really broad range of people. I know someone was asking a question about singing. Can you sing in UCD? We have choral scholars in UCD. So there are special scholarships even for singers who like to sing, and they are really excellent, but there are also lots of other opportunities to sing in different ways. There's the gamelan orchestra, which you can be part of if you're studying music or not, and that I think it's actually a module in the music department, and that doesn't require any musical experience at all in terms of playing an instrument, because you're going to learn to do it as part of the module.
That's great. Next up, we have a few questions about DramSoc. I think DramSoc is well known for many generations right across town and internationally. Mel and Niamh, I know you've both been involved. Rebecca, I'm not sure if your paths have crossed with the DramSoc, but would anyone like to come in and talk to us a little bit about this wonderful community that is DramSoc?
Hopefully my internet doesn't go again while I talk about it, but DramSoc is one of the best things I've done in UCD. I sound like a bit of a nerd when I talk about it, but I love it so much. It is how I made the majority of my friends in college, just people with a similar interest as you and also a similar work ethic. You will never learn to work as hard anywhere else but in that theatre, where you go and you start doing a get-in at 9 a.m. and you could be there until 3 a.m. and it's a lot of work, but it's really good, and you can kind of dip in and out of it, whether you do one show or you do 15. And you don't just need to be an actor. Like, if you want to do set or
lighting design, makeup, you want to write, we have a writer's workshop, we have a play group. There are so many things you can get involved in. And having our own space in the theatre really does make it such a hub for the community as well. Like, the doors are always open, there's always someone in the office, the kettle's always on. It's an amazing place, and it's a really good place to find your home away from home. It was for me anyway.
And Jamel, would you like to add anything about DramSoc?
I'm afraid this is Neve's area of expertise completely. I've only been a spectator with DramSoc. I've had friends that are involved in it, and they're all fantastic people. And I will say the productions that I've seen have been absolutely phenomenal. Rivals some of the shows that I've seen in smaller theatres in town and the bigger ones. And that's not me being biased at all. Really, really, you can see visually that a lot of passion and love goes into these productions.
And it's a great experience for all involved. We've gone through an awful lot of questions here. I just thought it might be a moment to pause for reflection and ask Rebecca, Niamh and Jamel to maybe give some pieces of advice. You know, if you're imagining yourself filling out your CAO or finalizing your application for the non-EU students that don't come through the CAO, what advice would you give to yourself when you were at that stage? Looking back, what are your reflections? What do you wish you'd known? What comforting or advice or words of wisdom can you give to everyone who's gathered here tonight?
I would say take your time and don't stress about it, and go with what feels right. I mean, I didn't start my undergrad until I was 21. And before that, I'd made a few choices. I went into another college and I did another course. And that reason being that the course that I'm in now just didn't exist. And when this course, like when I saw this course advertised, or I don't know if that's the right word, advertised, false advertised, the word I use, but that I made my decision to withdraw from my other course and come to UCD, and that is the decision that has stood for me from that point on. I didn't really concern myself with anything other than knowing that this is what I love, this is what I want to do. And because of that, I've been able to flourish at it. And like, you're going to do the things you love best. I mean, it's a no-brainer. And good things will come from that. If you do something well, good things will come from it. You know, that's it. Yeah, just, you know, I don't want to say follow your heart because I'm being recorded, but follow your heart.
What great advice. What about you, Rebecca? Or Niamh, whoever wants to come in first.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I think something I struggled with, and just seeing a lot of people had some questions about that, was kind of thinking that you should already know everything before coming. And it's new for everyone, like you won't know it, and that's okay, but other people won't either. And you're there to learn. And like, by the end of first year, you'll be up to scratch with everyone, like everyone will be on the same level. And so I think to kind of work on getting rid of that idea that like, oh, everyone will know more than me, or, you know, because you'll all be at the same level, you know, even before, I'd say probably by the end of the first semester. And then the other thing would be, I think it's been mentioned a lot, but societies, that's really the best way to get involved and to meet people. And as we said, there's one for everything, so you'll be able to find one, and that's a really good way to settle in.
Thanks, Rebecca. Niamh, over to you.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, just totally agreeing with the two guys have said here. I think follow your heart and trust your gut is absolutely the way to go. I know, like, when I was picking my course, like, I think Jamel relates to me here, we were the guinea pig year with humanities. We were the first year, so we were just really trusting what UCD had to offer, and it has absolutely paid off. It's been such a pleasure to study in UCD and to have the opportunities we've had. And I think that's all I can recommend, is like, anything that comes your way, take it, you know, run into it, try everything. Even if you don't think it's for you, because you never know what's going to be like the thing that changes your life, essentially. And just experiencing new things and meeting new people in a community as big as UCD, like, everything is possible there. And I think we can all attest to that, absolutely.
That's great. And Gillian, can I come to you maybe for some final words? Because I think we should probably close out the session now. And thank you to everyone for joining us and for all the fabulous questions. We haven't got to all of them, but we will follow up through email. Gillian, would you like to give any advice or any final words?
I think that Rebecca and Jamel and Niamh said it so beautifully. I think
bring your heart, roll up your sleeves, ready to do some work, and the rest happens when you get here, because we're all learning, and I love that about my job. I learn something new every single day, and that's an absolute joy because no one can ever take that away. And no matter how difficult things are out there, if you can still keep learning things, if you can still keep expanding your horizons up here, that means a lot. It really does. So I hope that everybody, I hope you got something from what we had to say today, and do keep in touch with us. Keep, just email us or pick up the telephone or whatever it is if you want to know more, and we'll do everything we can to help. Whatever you decide to do, I hope that it works out really well for you. And I hope that you stay safe, and I just want to wish you all the best of luck with everything that is to come over the next few months. Take care. Thanks for coming.